In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. We have lit the candles of hope, of peace, of love. In the glow of their light, we feel the warmth of deep and quiet joy.
Offers us hope in the prison of the Spirit.
Peace in the chaos of life.
God's love, graciously, silently, only walk.
God has lifted up the lowly and filled the hungry with good things.
From generation to generation, God is faithful. We leave with joy who feel God.
We light this candle to proclaim the coming of the light of God into the world. With the coming of this light, there is joy. Joy that is ours, not only at Christmas, but always. We worship God with joy in our hearts, as we are reminded of the words the angel said on that first Christmas day. Behold, I bring you good news of a great joy which will come to all the people. Lighting the fourth Advent candle.
Let us join together in prayer. O Holy One, as Christmas draws near, there is a sense of excitement in the air. We can feel a joy in our lives and see it in those around us. Let us come before a forgiving God. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us. But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. O God, you have called us to be apostles of your grace, but we have been judgmental instead of gracious. We condemned in others what is also all too often in us. We refuse to listen to others' pain or to understand the source of their tears. We avoid those who are angry or scornful or bitter. It is easier to dismiss the feelings of others than to offer true empathy. We would rather reject than encounter them.
Hi, Daddy.
Yet you come to us, Emmanuel, and we want to repent. You reach out to us, and our hearts melt. We want to embrace this new life. Amen. Lord, have mercy upon us. Christ, have mercy upon us. Lord, have mercy upon us. In the mercy of Almighty God, Jesus Christ was given to die for you. And for his sake, God forgives you all your sins. To those who believe in Jesus Christ, he gives the power to become the children of God and bestows on them the Holy Spirit. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel.
In Jesus Christ we are forgiven.
O Lord, open my lips.
Thank you.
Father, we give thanks for this day and the chance to gather here in your house. We ask that you hear our prayers, our songs of praise and thanksgiving. We ask that you refresh our spirits until we again gather here in your house. We ask this in the name of our Lord, Jesus Christ. Amen.
Today's Old Testament lesson is from Isaiah 7, 10 to 16. The kings of Syria and Israel are bent on conquering Jerusalem and installing a puppet king on Judah's throne. One night, descending from David, God has told Ahaz, king of Judah, to trust in God rather than in human counsel. If Ahaz stands firm in faith, the conquest will fail. Listen now what the Spirit is saying to the church. A reading from Isaiah. The Lord spoke to Ahaz, saying, ask a sign of the Lord your God, let it be deep as Sheol or high as heaven. But Ahaz said, I will not ask, and I will not put the Lord to the test. Then Isaiah said, hear then, O house of David, is it too little for you to weary mortals that you weary my God also? Therefore the Lord himself will give you a sign. Look, a young woman is with child and shall bear a son, and his name shall be Emmanuel. He shall eat curds and honey by the time he knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good. For before the child knows how to refuse the evil and choose the good, the land before whose two kings you are in dread will be deserted. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Today's epistle lesson comes from Romans 1, 1 to 7. The church at Rome was one Paul had neither founded nor visited. Although he hopes to meet the members of this community soon to share spiritual gifts with them and for the encouragement of their families and his. Listen once again for the word of God. A reading from Romans. Paul, a servant of Jesus Christ, called to be an apostle, set apart for the gospel of God, which he promised beforehand through his prophets in the Holy Scriptures, the gospel concerning his Son, who was descended from David according to the flesh, and was declared as the Son of God, with power according to the Spirit of holiness by resurrection from the dead, Jesus Christ our Lord, through whom we have received grace and apostleship, to bring about the obedience of faith among all the Gentiles for the sake of his name, including yourselves who are called to belong to Jesus Christ. To all God's beloved in Rome who are called to be saints, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. The word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Our gospel lesson this morning is from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus the Messiah took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband Joseph, being a righteous man, and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel, which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. This ends the reading of the Holy Gospel.
Thank you.
May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be accepted in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. May the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be accepted in thy sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Well, here we are, just 2 days before Christmas. I know everybody's ready, right? I know all the kids are getting excited looking forward to Christmas morning. And of course, there's the people running around doing the last minute shopping. I hate to admit it, but I used to be one of those people that used to do their shopping on Christmas Eve. It's not because I wanted to or because I was looking for those last minute bargains, but it was because I'm just not a very good shopper. My wife Barbara would give me a list of the things she wanted, and usually it would be clothes, fashion accessories, and perfume. And I hate to admit it, but when it comes to women's clothes, I don't know anything about sizes, I sure don't know about colors, and I don't know about the current styles. When it comes to perfume, I always thought that a whole gallon for $4 was a pretty good deal. Now, if she would ask for something like a nice power drill or a chainsaw, I would remember it had that effort. But she would never make it that easy for me. So here I am on Christmas Eve, running around trying to finish all the shopping, knowing that the clock is ticking down on me, and knowing that I better have presents under that tree on Christmas morning. Well, I always seem to make it. I was so glad when my two daughters got old enough that they could help me go out with my shopping. They still help me to this day, and I told them this morning that if they didn't know it, they do now, that it's a lifetime job for them. Now, even though Barbara would give me this list of the things she wanted, I would always try to find something special, try to find that one perfect gift that she didn't ask for. So whenever I would hear an ad on television or radio or see something in a newspaper that advertised the perfect gift, it would definitely get my attention. But I finally come to realize that I will never be able to give this perfect gift. It's not because I don't want to or because I'm tired of trying. It's because it's already been given. As a matter of fact, it's been given to all of us. It was given to us about 2,000 years ago. It wasn't wrapped in pretty paper or a fancy bow. It was wrapped in a blanket and placed in the manger. This perfect gift was a baby named Jesus. And it was given to us by a loving God who knew what his children needed more than anything else, a Savior. And what makes this gift so perfect? Well, to start with, it's a gift that's right for everyone. It doesn't matter if you're male or female, if you're young or you're old, or you're rich or you're poor. It's a gift that every one of us will have need of. It's a gift that we can never lose. We can't leave home without it, because no matter where we go on this earth, this gift will always be with us. Once we have this gift, nobody can ever take it from us. They can't steal it. They can't cheat it out of us. It's always there. And unlike a lot of the gifts, most of the gifts we receive, this gift will never wear out or run down. Because this gift is powered by the Holy Spirit, which means that it will last forever. This truly is the one gift that keeps on giving. And what other gift do we have that we can get mad with, that we get angry with, that we can abuse it, cuss it, and everything else? And yet, it will forgive us instantly. All we have to do is ask for forgiveness. And this is a gift that if we know how to receive it, it helps us deal with all the things in life that comes our way. And at the end of this life, this gift will lead us into heaven to spend eternity with God. It's not going to get any better than that. We've all heard the expression, you can't take it with you. Well, when we talk about this gift, the appropriate expression should be, you can't get there without it. I think the key point here is knowing how to receive this gift. There's a big difference between knowing that it's there actually receiving. It's not like any other gift we have ever received. We can't touch it. We can't see it. We can't hear it. This isn't a material gift that we can reach out and take hold of in our hands. This is a spiritual gift that we have to receive in our hearts and in our souls. I'm afraid that we have become so conditioned to gifts that stimulate our senses, gifts that give us an instant gratification, that we've lost the knowledge of receiving gifts that stimulate our spirits. These are gifts that give us eternal gratification. Now the people 2,000 years ago, they didn't know what to do with this gift. They most of them weren't aware at the time of Jesus' birth that it was a gift to them. Now there was a few prophets like Isaiah that had told about the coming of Messiah. And of course there was Mary who knew. But as we heard this morning in the gospel, Joseph didn't even know. I mean, here he was ready to leave the woman he was to marry because she was carrying a child that wasn't his. And it wasn't until an angel of God came to him and explained so that he understood what was going on. Now, all the time Jesus was growing up, people around him was unaware of what this gift that was given to us. And it wasn't until his 30s that he began his ministry that people finally had a chance to start seeing what this gift was all about. But it really wasn't until after Jesus' death and his resurrection that the full value of this gift was revealed to them. Now, even though many people, they witnessed the power of this gift, they heard about it, they still would not receive it. So it's no wonder that people today are not sure how to receive this gift. I can't imagine that there's too many people who haven't heard about Jesus. But yet some people just choose to ignore it. You say, I'll put it on the side, maybe someday I'll need it or I'll come around to it. While other people, they get it out, they bring it with them on Sunday for about an hour, then they go home and they put it away again. And then there's other people who say, yeah, I know it's there. If I run into a problem in my life where I have a hard time, then I'll get it down and use it. They don't realize that they're cheating themselves of the opportunity to experience the full power and majesty of this wonderful gift. You see, this is a gift that the more you use it, the better it works. Receiving this gift in our lives can make such a difference. I'm sure there would be some skeptic that would ask me, well, what has it done for you? Well, to start with, I like to think that it's made me more patient, more understanding with all the people and all the situations I encounter in my life. I feel like I've been able to withdraw from the rat race and step back and appreciate and understand some of the small things in life that I've never noticed before. Now, I'm afraid to look over here to my wife, and I hope she's not in agreement with what I'm telling her. Another thing this has done for me is my self-confidence has definitely grown. If you would have told me a couple years ago that one day I'd be up here leading worship and delivering the message, well, let's just say after I had stopped laughing, I would have said, ain't no way you're getting me up here. But yet, here I am. This gift has made me aware that my life is not a rehearsal for where I will spend eternity. It's the actual performance. I know that someday I will be judged by the way I live my life. And I don't want to waste some of the opportunity. This gift will mean different things to different people. That's where all of us become very, very important. This makes a great gift to share with someone else. This is the responsibility that's been left to us as Christians. We need to take time to show other people that this gift is there for them. We need to teach them how to receive it. If you're not quite sure how to do it, don't worry. God knew that we were going to have a problem with this, so he sent us an instruction manual. It's called the Bible. I guarantee you that if you share this gift with somebody else, it'll be one gift that they never return. 2,000 years ago, when Jesus was born, there was no room for him at the inn. Is there room in our hearts for him today? So in 2 days, it will be Christmas. And we'll all be celebrating with our families and friends. And the one question that will be asked over and over again, what did you get for Christmas? I hope we can all say, I received the perfect gift. Amen. Let us now reaffirm our faith using the Apostles' Creed found on page 38 of the hymnal. This time, let us come before God in prayer. Let us pray. Our Holy Father, we ask for your blessings throughout this world. We ask that you bless the President of the United States and all the leaders of the world. Fill them with the spirit of wisdom, goodness, and truth, so that justice and peace may prevail everywhere. And all your children of the world can joyously proclaim peace on earth and goodwill toward men. We ask your blessings for this church and all the members of this household of faith. Enlighten us as ministers of your truth and of your grace. We ask you to bless the pastor search committee. Guide them as they seek to find the right person to be the spiritual leader of this church. We ask for the power of your healing and comfort for those whose names we offer up. We lift up the names of Calvin Kellner, Doris Lawrence, Lena Kemp, Ann Mishkar, Ruth Pierce, Gloria Frampton, Henry Will, Mutz, Ernie and Melissa, the Petrosky family, Pyle family, the Morgan family, Margaret Fitzberger, Agnes Wally, Karen and Ryan, Jean, the Caravaggio families, Georgiatis families, the Lockhart families, Alma, Tricia, Rudy, Sally and Terry Ruth, Mrs. Elsie, Stephen, BJ, Nancy, Avis, the Meyer family, Carlisle Clay, Edward Schley, Benjamin Mickey, Ed Stanton, the Gangman family, Knowles family, Stella, Marion, Trudy, Sissy Rowe, Joyce Otilia, Christina Davis, Elise Ketchum, Irma and Sarah Andrade, Richard Francis, Catherine Day, Warren Norland, Baby Holton, Timothy, Charles, Owens families, the Werner families, Betty and Mother, Ruth and John, Betty. We lift up and honor those in whose names memorials have been placed. Dorothy Burke, Evelyn Steele, Charles Rachel, Ernestine Huth, Walter Pagucki, Elaine Bergen, Waverly Love. We give thanks for the blessings of having these people as being a part of our lives. And now hear us as we pray the prayer taught us by our Lord Jesus. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thank you.
We ask that you receive these gifts as a small token of thanks from that which we first received. We ask that they be used to proclaim the gospel throughout this community and throughout the world. Amen. Christmas. We have always been told that it is better to give than to receive. This is the exception to that rule. Let us open our hearts and receive this gift from God. And may the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with us now and forever. Amen.